Hi, I am Sudhakar Pamarthy, Professor of Electrical Engineering at the University of California, Los Angeles. Let me tell you about some of my most favorite circuit blocks, the delta sigma fractional and phase lock loops. These are popular circuit blocks which are used in a wide range of applications in frequency synthesis, clock generation, synchronization, and so on. So let me show you with a block diagram. Okay. So here's a very high-level block diagram of the delta sigma, of the fractional and phase lock loop. Essentially, it's a negative feedback system. So there is a voltage-controlled oscillator, VCO, whose output frequency is proportional to its control voltage, VC. The output of the VCO is divided by a frequency divider by n plus y of n, where n and y of n are both integers. The phase frequency detector, or PFD, the charge pump, and the loop filter, all of these things together, they compare the phase of the divider with that of a stable low noise reference, and then accordingly adjust the control voltage. So let me illustrate. Here are example waveforms. So you can see the divider output, reference output. So if the divider output lags the reference, then the negative feedback loop will sense that the VCO is slower, and hence it will raise the control voltage to effectively speed it up. Similarly, if the divider output leads the reference, then the opposite happens. So this negative feedback action basically will force the output frequency, the PLL's frequency, to be exactly n plus alpha times FF, where FF is the frequency of the reference and alpha is the average of the sequence of integers y of n. Okay? So this is very interesting because now, for a given reference frequency, I can change alpha in tiny increments and basically achieve very fine resolution frequency synthesis. What's the problem? Well, unfortunately, y of n is never equal to alpha. Y of n are integers and alpha is fractions. So consequently, there are always instantaneous frequency errors between the reference and the divider. The PLL senses the resultant phase errors and tries to track them within its bandwidth, but suppresses what is beyond. Okay? As a result, there is inevitable undesired excess phase, which we are calling phi PLL in this system. So let's take a closer look at this phi PLL. Here I'm showing you a simplified block diagram of what happens, signal processing operations in a fractional phase lock loop. It seems very complicated, but let me explain. It's actually fairly simple. First, you have this y of n minus alpha. Basically, these represent the instantaneous frequency errors. They are called the quantization noise. Now, the integrator, the z inverse over 1 minus z inverse, it's a digital integrator, that represents the instantaneous phase errors. Now this ITM block here basically simply converts the sequence of instantaneous phase errors to a sequence of analog phase errors. And subsequently, the PLL will basically low pass filter these analog phase errors. And the low pass filtering action of the PLL is shown by this low pass filter with a bandwidth of PLL band of BW. Bottom line, what we are saying is that the fractional n phase lock loop performance is dictated by the properties of this so-called quantization noise, or y of n minus alpha. Before I start talking about how we should choose y of n to make this system work well, let's talk briefly a bit about what are the performance metrics of interest. First of all, we are interested in what are called spurs or spurious tones. So let me give you an example. Here I'm showing you the measured power spectral density of a PLL output, a fractional phase lock loop output. The reference frequency is 48 MHz, n is 51, and alpha is, let's say, 0.0875. As expected, this large central spike is exactly at n plus alpha times FRF, or 2.451 GHz in this case. Okay? Unfortunately, there are several other tones as well. So there are some which are exactly FRF away from the center frequency, and these are called reference spurs. Also, there are some other spurs which are at alpha times FRF away from the center frequency, and sometimes the harmonics of alpha times FRF. So these are called fractional spurs. Okay, and spurs are typically characterized in terms of how many dB they are below the carrier. Apart from spurs, we also care about what's called phase noise. Okay, so for example, let's say if I zoom in close to the carrier, what I would see is something like this. So this is called phase noise. What we are plotting here, basically, if you see that blue curve, what we are plotting there is basically the power in the excess phase, a power in the PLL output within a 1 Hz band normalized to the carrier frequency and measured at a certain offset. So for example, at a 1 MHz offset, we are saying that the power in the PLL output is about 110 dB below the carrier, and we call that minus 110 dB C per Hz. Generally speaking, we want both fractional spurs and the phase noise and the reference spurs, they all to be very, very low. Okay, now let's come back to our original question. How do we choose Y of N? Okay, just to remind you, Y of N minus alpha represents instantaneous frequency errors. They are integrated, scaled, and low pass filtered. So if you want very low phase noise and very few spurs, what we want is we want two things. Number one, we want the quantization noise, or Y of N minus alpha, to have very little low frequency content. That way, any high frequency current is suppressed by the PLL, and whatever is inside the PLL bandwidth is very little. Furthermore, we want the quantization noise to not be periodic, because if it is periodic, then the excess phase phi PLL will be periodic and you will see strong spurs. So now the question becomes one of a simple signal processing question. How do you quantize a given sequence alpha to a sequence of integers Y of N such that these two nice properties are achieved? Let me walk you through the how this has evolved. Okay. Originally, people came up with this what are called the original fractions. So what they did there was they took the fraction alpha and they applied it to a digital accumulator. The 1-bit carry out of this accumulator was used as the sequence Y of N. Here's an example scenario where alpha is 0.2. As you can clearly see, the sum increases as 0.2, 0.4, so on. And the carry out is basically a periodic signal which goes 0001 and again repeats 00001 and so on. So clearly, Y of N is periodic and hence the quantization noise is periodic, so that's not good for us. Furthermore, if you look at the quantization noise, it's a fairly slowly varying signal. It's minus for a long time and then jumps to 0.8 and then again minus 0.2 for a long time. That slowly varying thing means it has a lot of low frequency content, which means you'll cause a lot of phase noise as well. So for these reasons, the original fraction approach is not going to work well now. Let's do a thought experiment to see what Y of N should really be. So for this, I'm considering a hypothetical quantizer. Okay, I'm calling it a coin toss quantizer. The idea is to have a biased coin. The probability of heads on this coin is alpha, let's say, and I toss this coin repeatedly. If I get a heads, I say Y of N is 1. If I get a tails, I say Y of N is 0. Clearly, the Y of N will have the right average alpha. Furthermore, because I'm doing random coin tosses, there is no periodicity here. That means I will not have fractional spurs. Unfortunately, my random coin tosses will basically make my quantization noise white, which means there is substantial low frequency content. So I'll have quite a bit of phase noise. Then people came up with this whole idea of a delta sigma modulator. The idea here is to have a quantizer, that's this block, the staircase-like block here, that quantizes from fractional values to nearest integers. Example integer values are 0, plus or minus 1, plus or minus 2. And they enclose this quantizer in negative feedback. This is an example negative feedback. You can construct other systems for other negative feedback as well. Bottom line, what happens is that if you think of this quantizer as an additive error source, Q of N, then you can treat this thing as a simple linear time invariant system with multiple inputs, and you can, with a little bit of algebra, you can show that the quantization noise is now Q of N minus 2 times Q of N minus 1 plus Q of N minus 2. You can check that this basically means a second order difference, basically means it is high pass filtering this additive quantization source Q of N. So now that means that using a delta sigma modulator, we do have very low frequency, little low frequency content. That means phase noise that is close into the carrier will be very, very low. Unfortunately, this is a deterministic system with feedback and strong nonlinearity. So as a result, you experience what are called limit cycles. To illustrate, consider this case. Let's say alpha is a constant, and you have these two integrators in the forward path going to R of N, the input of the quantizer. You can show that alpha will, the input of the quantizer will increase parabolically, and every now and then it's going to get quantized, reset back to zero. That will cause Y of N to be very, very periodic, and the quantization noise to be periodic as well. So that means this delta sigma modulator, while it shapes the quantization noise out of band, high pass filters it, it still has very strong spurious content. So it's not good in that sense. Subsequently, people figured out a very simple solution to this thing. They said, let's take a 1-bit random sequence and add it to the least significant bit of the input. It turns out the high pass shaping of the quantization noise is still in effect. On top of that, this 1-bit dither or 1-bit random sequence, it accumulates to break up any periodic behavior. Because it is random, it breaks up any periodic behavior. As a result, the quantization noise is not even periodic now. So now we finally have a reasonably good solution. Okay. One thing before we move on. So LSB dithering, as this is called, does not work always. The dither needs to see at least 2 integrators before it gets to the quantizer. And the second rule of thumb is that the output of the delta sigma modulator, it cannot be restricted to only 1 bit. It has to have multiple levels. Anyway, so let me show you an example of a dithered delta sigma fractional phase lock loop. So you have the fractional phase lock loop, reference is 48 megahertz, alpha is 0.0875 as an example, and we are adding a plus or minus 1 LSB random dither. I am plotting here simulated power spectral densities of both the quantization noise, the PLL output, as well as the PLL phase noise. As you can see, both in the quantization noise as well as in the PLL's excess phase, phi PLL, there are no spurts, okay, and you have nice smooth power spectral density. So that in a nutshell is very high level is what a delta sigma fractional phase lock loop, a reasonably good one. Now we have not talked about the actual circuits themselves, because the circuits are fairly simple. However, when you're building an actual delta sigma fractional phase lock loop, a few things are important to look out for. Number one, any errors in the circuits, particularly in the divider, frequency divider, or in the phase detector, or in the charge pump, they can cause strong spurious tones. Basically, they unmask any periodicity that is there in the delta sigma modulator operation itself. Another important thing to note is the following. The delta sigma fractional phase lock loop is essentially has 2 clock domains. There are circuitry operating on the FRF domain and there are circuitry operating on FPLL. And FPLL and FRF are not harmonically related. So that means that if there is some signal from the FRF domain, if it couples into the VCO domain, it could be something as simple as substrate noise or supply ringing or anything like that. Because these two are in different domains, the frequencies could beat and you will have strong fractional spurs at their beat frequencies or fractional spurs. Another thing to note, look for is basically excess phase noise. The very act of changing y of n constantly will result in some phase noise. The PLL filters most of it, but still a residue can be remaining. And as always, the voltage controlled oscillators is a fairly noisy block. So that presents a lot of noise in the phase lock loop as well. And if you are talking about a delta sigma fractional phase lock loop in an integrated setting, you always have area and power issues. Okay? So that is all I have to say about a delta sigma fractional phase lock loop. At this year's CICC 2017, this year's CICC, basically we have some very interesting papers that are related or relevant to fractional phase lock loops. Most of them are in section 3. For example, 3.1 talks about how to use related PLLs to generate spectrum clocks. 3.4 talks about a lot more intelligent ways of choosing y of n, and which could be used as replacements to the delta sigma modulator itself. And finally, 3.3 basically presents a technique that suppresses the noise from the oscillator inside the fractional phase lock loop. Let me finish by basically giving you a list of references. These are fairly old references that talk about various aspects of the delta sigma modulator, dithering, fractional phase lock loop, and so on. Thank you for listening to me.